ever wondered why our nerd friends can't stop talking about Bitcoin or why they're always forcing you to buy Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies? Well, if that's the case, then this video is for you. Don't worry, I'm not gonna persuade you to buy Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin or smash the like button. This video is based on a book called The Bitcoin Standard by Saifedean Ammous, and I would definitely recommend you to give it a read. I am recording this after I finished editing the video and I realized that the video is a bit too lengthy. So I divided it into two parts. This is part one, and I would highly recommend you to watch it if you don't know anything about how money works and what can be considered as currency or store of value and all those things. But if you know what it is, then you can skip to the second part. And after I finish making that part, which will be 1 week after I release this video, you will find that link above or at the end or in the description. Okay, so let's continue. Now, before we discuss Bitcoin, just so we are on the same page, let's discuss what is money. Can anyone make it? What are the characteristics of money? What can be termed as money? Who can make it? How much can they make it? Can anyone press the subscribe button? Definitely yes. And other things about what categorizes as money. So there are four characteristics of money. There can be more or less, but I define them as four characteristics of money. Also, if you get confused anywhere in between, don't worry. We are going to discuss some examples which will make everything clear. So number one, medium of exchange. Now this good, which we categorize as money, should only be used for medium of exchange. It should be basically useless otherwise. It should not be used for consumption, for production of other goods. Like today we have dollar, we have papered currency. So that currency is basically useless. That is useless unless you wanna sew it and make clothes out of it or other things, it's useless. Second point is salability across space, scales and time. What do I mean by that? So this good which we are thinking of making as money should be salable, which means it should be able to sold. It should maintain its value. It should facilitate in selling. You get that? Well, here's the better definition. So it should be salable across scales, which means it should be divisible, should be easy to divide it into quantities. So if I want to buy something that is less valuable, I should be able to buy with that. If I want to buy something which is more valuable, I should be able to buy with that. It should be salable across space, which means it should be easy for that good to be carried around. So if I want to purchase something, let's say 10 kilometers away, I should be able to take that money 10 kilometers away. Otherwise, if I can't take it, I can't purchase that good. And salability across time means it should maintain its value for long periods of time. If a good that does not maintain its value for a long period of time, it will lose its value. And if a good loses its value, you won't want to keep it. So if money loses its value, whereas gold increases in value, you would want to put your value in money or gold. Obviously gold, because it increases in value. And by value, we don't mean the number like $1,000, $1,000,000 or $1,000,000,000,000. By value, we mean the purchasing power of what it can buy. So $1 cannot even buy me a phone, but one Bitcoin can buy me a phone and a car. This image does the best job of explaining what purchasing power looks like. Third point is hard money. What does hard money mean? Hard money basically is anything which is hard to produce. So whatever good that we are thinking of making as money, it should be hard to produce. Why it should be hard to produce? Because if it is easy to produce, then everyone would rather produce that money rather than working on other things. So for example, let's take an example of gold. Everyone knows that gold has a lot of value. So why don't we see everyone trying to dig gold? Because it's very hard to find. You have to first detect it, then dig it up, then find it, then clean it, all those things. That is why gold has value. If it was easy to find it and produce it, then everyone would rather involve themselves in that work. And I won't be making videos, you won't be doing whatever you do, there won't be any other jobs, everyone would rather do that job. So production of money should not be profitable, because everyone would produce it. I might be thinking, how can I produce money? I don't have a printing press like the government does. That is because right now it's illegal to print money. But when there was no system of government issued notes, then people could very well dig gold and do whatever they want. Or if it was seashells, they can easily find seashells. Or if it was some kind of rock, they could find rock. So you get the point. And why we don't want that to happen? Because if it's easy to do, then the supply of that good will increase drastically and the prices will increase even more. So basically there will be inflation, and those who have already stored that money, value of that money will go down. We'll discuss all that in the example. It will be clear, so don't worry. Number four, and probably the most important point, it should be a good store of value. Now, what do I mean by a good store of value? So whatever good we are thinking of making as money, again, that good should retain its value with time or should increase in value with time. Why? So for example, I am making videos right now. To make videos, I need gear. And to make better videos, I need better gear. So what will I do with whatever money I can get? I will try to collect it, and when the time comes, when I have enough money to buy, say, a better laptop, a better camera, I would invest that money to buy that good. But for that to happen, I need to first store it. I need to first collect it. Now, let's say I earn $100 a month and an iPad or a laptop costs around $1,000. So I would store my money for 10 months. And when it's equivalent to $1,000, I will buy that laptop. But once I have $1,000, if the value of money decreases, if the purchasing power of money decreases, then the laptop will cost more. My $1,000 won't be enough to buy a laptop which is now worth $1,100. So what has happened? Inflation, and the value of money has decreased. So in a society where that happens, what will people do? They won't store money. Why won't they store money? Because it will devalue in time. So rather I just spend it right now when it's worth more, rather than store it and spend it for less. Right. Now think of a farmer or an industrialist who want to buy a new farm or set up a new factory. They would have to collect large sums of money. But if the value of money keeps going down with time, then they won't be able to collect no matter what. And so rather than collecting money and investing it for long term, they will just consume it and the production will decrease, which won't be good for the society. So at the rightmost we have sound money, and leftmost we have unsound money. Okay, now let's look at some examples to better understand the points we discussed right now. So a long time ago, in an island called Yap, stones were used as a form of exchange. These stones were called rye stones. So first point is medium of exchange. Now rye stones are basically stones. So they are basically useless for any form of consumption or to produce any good. They can't do anything. So yeah, they take the first point. They can be used as medium of exchange. The second point is salability across space, scales and time. Now these stones come in varying sizes. So salability across scale is kinda okay, because I mean you won't find the exact size of a stone, but yeah, you can manage. Salability across space. So the island is pretty small, there are only few villagers, so it's not that hard to carry these stones in a village. So yeah, that also we can work with. Salability across time. Yes, the most important point, salability across time, gets checked in here, because these stones are very hard to find. They are in a different island altogether, and islanders don't have the technology, they don't have ships to carry these stones easily from that island to their own island, which means a single person simply can't increase the lot of supply. Third point, hard money. Basically the same thing, as this good is hard to attain and you can't produce it because it's a stone, and that stone is not available in your island. The only option is to go to that island and carry it with you, and you can't carry it easily. You can carry it off, that's why it's there, but it's very hard to do it. So yeah, hard money, check. So the fourth point is store of value, and again the same thing, the supply cannot be increased a lot. No single individual can bring in so much stone as per their current technology. So yeah, it's a good store of value, and villagers have been using it for a long time, for centuries, so it is expected to hold value for a long time. But in 1871, something unexpected happened. An Irish-American captain by the name David Keefe. So his ship was wrecked and he was revived by the locals. Now David saw that these guys use rye stones as a medium of exchange, as money, and he wanted coconut from them so that he could take back the coconut back to his place and sell it to the producers who make coconut oil. So he asked the locals for his own currency if they will be willing to give him some coconut. But of course, as the village was small, they only transacted between themselves. They really didn't want that currency which that person David was giving. So David decided to get these stones by himself. He went to that island as he had ships and resources, explosives. He could easily carry a lot of these stones in his ship and bring back to the Yap Island. And he did that. But the head of the island decided that they won't accept his stones because they were not attained by hard work and by sweat, but it was very easy for him to do it in his ship. But of course, not everyone agreed because the coconut producers saw an opportunity and he was willing to pay a good price. And with time, eventually, rice stones lost their value and they were no longer the medium of exchange in Yap Island. So just imagine, for centuries they have been using this system, and just one scenario, when you have the technology to attain that good, increase the supply, it totally changed what is considered as money for these islands. Now let's look at another example. For around 2500 years, gold, silver and copper were used as a form of currency. So first it started with weight. Every time you wanted to trade, you have to weigh these metals, and based on their weight, you could buy a particular good. But with time, as metallurgy improved, these metals can now be minted in coins, so you don't have to calculate the weight every time. But another problem that happened with this system was that now you can collect this coin and take out the gold from them and mix it with something else and hide the actual content of the gold. And yeah, basically, you're stealing, and governments did that, kings did that, people did that, and whoever wanted to can actually do it. So that is why gold and silver and copper coins lost their value, and now we don't use them as medium of exchange. But there is something particularly interesting about gold and silver. Gold and silver are very rare metals compared to other metals, so they are very hard to first of all find and clean and then be used as currency. With copper, what happened is the technology progressed, and as we needed more copper for everything like wires and electricity and for everything, copper became a very abundant metal. Why? Because we now have the technology to extract copper, and it turns out there is a lot of copper in Earth. And because we needed copper, we developed the technology and now we have a lot of copper basically. And as the demand for copper increased and supply increased, copper is not as valuable as gold, silver, and basically it's a commodity now, so you can't use it as money. But we still use gold and silver as a store of value because we still haven't figured out the technology to increase the supply of gold and silver so drastically that they lose their value. By the 19th century, we had the technology where we could easily communicate with each other. There were trains and forms of transport which allowed transactions to happen much faster, and we couldn't simply use gold coins and silver coins. So what happened? We came up with the gold standard. In the gold standard, the banks would take all the gold from the people and they would issue government issued notes which could be easily transacted, and these notes basically represented gold. So instead of carrying a little amount of gold, you would rather carry a dollar, a note which is equivalent to the particular amount of gold in the treasury. Its tragic flaw was that the control of these treasury were with central banks and the government. So what happened when the war break out, the World War I and the World War II, these parties, they kept producing more notes than they had the gold reserve. Why? Because they had to pay the soldiers, they had to produce weapon, and they simply couldn't afford to lose the war. Because if they lost the war, then it would be bad in the short term, but we can argue that in the long term it would have better effects for the economy, because war wouldn't have continued for long as long as it continued. I'm not sure exactly how long it continued, but in the times when we were using gold coins, because the gold was limited and you could not print anything, these gold coins were limited and they would easily exhaust and the wars would stop because king can't give money to people to fight. So basically the wars would stop, leading to the victory of a king who has more gold. But now, as everyone can print, Britain can print, US can print, Germany can print, They started printing money to give it to soldiers and to make more weapons. So what happened? The wars progressed and progressed. More people were killed. And at the end, the people who hold their money lost their values. So that's why there's a very famous picture. A person is carrying a wagon of cash to buy a bread, loaf of bread. That shows how much it led to the inflation and what happens when you leave the control or supply of money to government and central banks. If you're wondering how it will help you understand what Bitcoin is and how it works, well, Bitcoin was meant to replace all these forms of currency and it was meant to become a store of value. So whatever we discussed right now will help us understand why Bitcoin is worthy of becoming a currency and why it's worth your money. So we saw that rhinestones are perfect for those villagers and it met all the criteria. But because it was valuable, everyone wanted to increase the supply, but they couldn't. Everyone wanted to have more of it, but they couldn't because they didn't have the technology. But as soon as that captain came, he had the technology, so increased the supply, and finally it lost its value. Same happened with the gold standard. It was not easy to transact with it, so central banks took it. It became centralized, and people lost their ability to keep their money with them and use it as a store of value because now central banks and government can print it whenever they want it. So we'll see why Bitcoin is different and why Bitcoin is immune to all these things. It's not centralized, it's decentralized first of all, and why its supply cannot be increased. The supply of gold and silver can increase when we have the technology. We don't have right now, but it doesn't mean we won't have it in the future. In the future, we may be able to extract gold from asteroids or from the mantle of the earth. But for Bitcoin, we'll see why it's different. So make sure to watch the second part. And if I have uploaded the video, you can find it here. So that's it. See you in part 2.